Okay, the title of today's presentation is Preeclampsia. First, we'll review our learning objectives. Number one, to define mild and severe preeclampsia. Number two, to understand the fetal and maternal effects of the disease. Number three, to learn the management and prevention strategies for preeclampsia and eclampsia. Preeclampsia is the combination of hypertension and proteinuria after 20 weeks gestation in a woman with previously normal blood pressure. In order to evaluate hypertension, the blood pressure is taken on two occasions, at least 6 hours apart while the patient is on bed rest. For mild preeclampsia, the systolic blood pressure needs to be greater than or equal to 140 millimeters of mercury, and the diastolic blood pressure greater than or equal to 90 millimeters of mercury. In order to evaluate proteinuria, a urine dip is measured on two occasions at least 4 hours apart, and to meet the diagnosis of mild preeclampsia, she needs to have 1+ on urine dip or 0.3 grams on a 24-hour urine collection. Severe preeclampsia is defined as hypertension with systolic blood pressure greater than 160 millimeters of mercury and or a diastolic blood pressure greater than or equal to 110 millimeters of mercury. Proteinuria is defined as 3+ on a urine dip or 5 grams on 24-hour urine collection. There are additional criteria for severe preeclampsia, which include oliguria, which is less than 500 milliliters of urine output in 24 hours, cerebral or visual disturbance, pulmonary edema or cyanosis, epigastric or right upper quadrant pain, impaired liver function, thrombocytopenia, fetal growth restriction. There are risk factors that are used to assess a patient's risk for developing preeclampsia. There is no single screening test that has been found to be reliable or cost-effective. Initial labs include a complete blood count to assess the patient's platelets and hematocrit, liver enzymes, creatinine, and a 24-hour urine collection. The risk factors include first pregnancy, history of preeclampsia or chronic hypertension, obesity, age greater than 35 years, African-American race, multifetal gestations, pregestational diabetes, nephropathy, vascular or connective tissue disease, and antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Preeclampsia can affect the end organs in the following systems. For the vascular system, vasospasm leads to hemoglobin concentration, and this vasospasm is secondary to interactions between vasoconstrictors, such as thromboxane A2 and endothelins, and vasodilators, including prostacyclin and nitric oxide. In the hematologic system, there can be development of HELLP syndrome, which is an acronym for hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, low platelets. In a patient with HELLP syndrome, hemolysis can be reflected as low hematocrit and a high lactate dehydrogenase level. This occurs in approximately 20% of women with severe preeclampsia and is associated with placental abruption, renal failure, preterm delivery, recurrent preeclampsia, and fetal or maternal death. In the hepatic system, there can be increased AST and ALT, the liver transaminases, or hyperbilirubinemia if there is hemolysis. There is a risk of subcapsular hematoma, which is associated with right upper quadrant pain, and rarely hepatic rupture can occur with a high mortality rate. In the neurologic system, there can be temporary blindness, and in cases of eclampsia, which is seizures in the setting of preeclampsia, there can be intracranial hemorrhage, headaches, scotomata, blurred vision, and hyperreflexia. In the renal system, due to the effects of vasospasm, there may be decreased blood flow and glomerular filtration rate. Thus, you may not see a decrease in the creatinine. However, you may observe oliguria, which is less than 500 milliliters of urine in 24 hours. There can be acute tubular necrosis, which can lead to acute renal failure. In the fetal system, there can be evidence of fetal growth restriction, oligohydramnios, non-reassuring fetal heart rate testing, and placental abruption. Next, I'd like to talk about the treatment for preeclampsia. For mild preeclampsia, we offer women a vaginal delivery at term. If the patient is preterm, we would offer outpatient management with routine maternal and fetal monitoring, which would include a non-stress test. If the non-stress test is not reactive, then a biophysical profile can be performed, which would assess for the fetal tone, breathing, gross movement, and the amniotic fluid index, as well as a growth ultrasound. The treatment for severe preeclampsia is different. A tertiary care center may be needed for fetal prematurity or for a maternal intensive care unit. Delivery is indicated at 32 to 34 weeks or earlier if the maternal or fetal status changes. There must be a balance of the maternal and fetal risks when determining the timing of delivery. Corticosteroids are administered for fetal lung maturation if the fetus is premature. Magnesium sulfate is used to reduce the seizure risk. Antihypertensive medication is used to prevent maternal stroke. Next, I'd like to talk about the management of blood pressure. Treatment is recommended for diastolic blood pressure greater than 105 to 110 millimeters of mercury. The goal blood pressure is a systolic of 140 to 155 and a diastolic of 90 to 105. Hydralazine, 5 to 10 milligrams IV, every 15 to 20 minutes is used until the desired effect. Alternatively, labetalol, 20 milligrams IV, every 10 minutes can be used. If the desired effect is not seen, you can double the dose to 40, then 80, at that interval every 20 minutes, up to a maximum dose of 220 milligrams. Oral labetalol can also be used. Lastly, oral nifedipine can be used. Prevention. While low-dose aspirin is occasionally used in women with pre-existing hypertension and renal disease, it was not effective in a randomized controlled trial of prima gravida women who were low risk in preventing preeclampsia. Daily calcium use has also not been proven effective to prevent preeclampsia. Trials of vitamin C and E did not impact the incidence of preeclampsia. While the pathogenesis of preeclampsia is generally thought to be due to inadequate invasion of the placental trophoblast in early pregnancy, our lack of a thorough understanding of the pathologic mechanism has thwarted prevention efforts. Lastly, eclampsia. Eclampsia is defined as the new onset of grand mal seizures in a woman with preeclampsia. The treatment is aimed to prevent the mother from harming herself, which would avoid a fall or aspiration event during the seizures. These seizures are usually self-limited, and the first priority is maternal stabilization. Magnesium sulfate is used to medically manage this patient's risk for further seizures. While fetal bradycardia is common during a seizure, the mother should be stabilized before moving toward delivery. Additional reading material is listed below. Please see the following journal articles for additional information about mild and severe preeclampsia. Thank you.